Lots of you saying you're surprised by the alert level changes after two new COVID community cases connected to the Auckland cluster were revealed at 1 o'clock yesterday, and then another one just prior to the PM's announcement at 4:30. I think many people assumed that Auckland would definitely be remaining at level three for another day or two or maybe three. So what was the rationale for the government's decision to move Auckland to level two and the rest of the country back to level one in around 10 minutes? Jenny May will be speaking to Associate Health Minister Dr. Aisha Verrill and asking her exactly that. But first, we're delighted as ever to welcome Shaun Hendy back to breakfast. Professor of Physics at the University of Auckland, Director of Te Pūnaha Matatini, a New Zealand Centre of Research Excellence, winner of the Prime Minister's Science Media Communication Prize, and a man whose modelling has informed at least some of the government's decisions on alert levels. I'd like to give you a good billing because you're a good bugger, Shaun Hendy, and you always come on. We're always grateful for you. Was your modelling involved in this decision?
We were modelling this week. I mean, we were kind of looking at the worst case scenarios. What, you know, if we did discover a big cluster out there, you know, because we knew it was the new variant, we were concerned about whether level three would actually cut it. So we were modelling that, and we were also looking at different, you know, depending on how the virus got in, how the family came into contact with the virus. We were looking at scenarios based on that.
So the worst possible scenario, which is what we need to know, and boy, that informed our original lockdown decision almost a year ago. Were you surprised that we went from three, that today we're in two in Auckland?
I think at the start of the week, you know, with the things looking a lot like that August cluster, you know, that alert level three, that, you know, for 3 days, I think was the right decision. But then, it didn't pan out that way over the rest of the week. You know, we didn't discover a bigger cluster. You think back to August, almost immediately we started to find more cases, including cases that could be upstream cases. This time we didn't find any upstream cases. You know, we didn't find any people that could have been between the family and the border. And that suggests, you know, now we still don't know how the family came into contact with the virus, but that does suggest that we did catch it very early. So good on that family for getting tested. And that's meant that we've been dealing with quite a small contained cluster. Can't completely rule out, you know, there's still being cases out there. You know, we may see a couple more cases downstream, you know, particularly associated with the school. And, you know, there's still the chance that there could be a bigger cluster growing out there. And that's why, you know, in alert level two in Auckland, we just can't relax. You know, this weekend, we've just got to be really vigilant and go get tested if we've got any symptoms.
But Professor Hendy, I'm somewhat confused about how it hasn't travelled further and wider to more people. And we think, you know, as a parent of two teenagers, we think of how tactile kids are at secondary school. They lope, you know, they lollop all over each other. The beginning of the year, you hug the kids you're pleased to see again. You know, there's lots of that kind of stuff going on. Given this is the new strain, the new variant, which we're told is more infectious, I don't know if you know the answer to this question, but how the hell has it not spread further?
Yeah, I mean, one of the answers is that this is a disease that spreads via super spreading events. You know, we know there are particular environments that are particularly risky for the spread of the virus. You know, we've seen the clusters last year in pubs associated with weddings, you know, big events where people are singing, speaking loudly. And, you know, sure, schools are environments where that does happen. But, you know, it's that kind of event that can lead to a large growing cluster. You know, we saw the church cluster as part of that August outbreak. And so, you know, we've got lucky here that none of the people who are infected in this time have sort of gone into one of those environments and spread it to large numbers of other people.
Gosh, this is a balancing act, isn't it? And there are so many things informing these decisions. We're getting a little bit of feedback from Māoridom saying, is this about commerce? Is this about freeing? Now, you can't answer this question. Is this about freeing Auckland up so that Hospo can have a weekend? But how the hell do we get this right? I guess the modelling and the science inform it first of all. And when you were modelling, the worst possible scenario was disastrous. But what did your modelling say about containment? Will we expect to see this dwindle away to nothing, hopefully, over the next few days?
Yeah, look, I mean, I think what, the, you know, the decision yesterday just reflects the government's increasing confidence in the contact tracing system. You know, we've had a lot of these little outbreaks previously, and we've seen that our contact tracers are really good now at putting a ring around them. and you know, stopping them in the you know, before they get large. You know, from a modelling perspective, as we watched during the week and we saw, you know, they weren't finding new cases, that started to tell us that we weren't looking at the worst case scenario. What would have been great would be if we'd known the source of the infection. That's a big that makes a big difference to our modelling predictions. But then, you know, there's also been new science that's been brought to bear this time. We've had the wastewater testing, you know, and that'll carry on over over the next few weeks, and we'll be able to monitor, you know, and that should give us an early heads up if we have missed some.
The other thing, and I know you really want to stress this, is testing. And once again, it's almost, without overstating the case, it's almost a civic responsibility to know where these people have been. So to go to Ministry of Health website and look at the places they've visited and think, was I there at the same time? Or if you are in any way symptomatic, get tested, right?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, when we've got little clusters like this, you know, people have to be really vigilant. You know, and good on this family again. You know, let's thank them for stopping a significant outbreak by going to get that test. And you know, it's all of our responsibility to do that. And by doing that, we can all keep our communities safe and avoid further lockdowns.
We had Chris Hipkins on the show on Tuesday or Wednesday, and he said New Zealanders are very good at responding when there's a new cluster or a new outbreak or whatever, but actually we become complacent really fast. And I think the message you keep making, Susie Wiles keeps making, Michael Baker keeps making, the minister keeps making, is complacency is our enemy. So the testing is vital. The social distancing is vital if we can manage it. The taking stock of where we are and making sure we're scanning in is vital. Do we still need to wear masks on public transport and do all that kind of stuff? Does that remain important?
Yeah, I mean, I think so. You know, Aucklanders have actually been pretty good at wearing masks on public transport. You know, since that August cluster, we had that experience of that quite frightening outbreak last year in Auckland. And I think people have kept that up. And so, you know, and it just reduces the risk should we have a community outbreak of it spreading further and faster than we can contain with our contact tracing. And of course, you know, when you're on a bus, when you're in contact with a lot of people you don't necessarily know, and you know that can make it very hard for contact tracers to find those people should you test positive. And so, wearing a mask helps keep the other people on your bus safe.
Shaun Hendy, we so appreciate you joining us. I just one final question. I want you to look back over the past year. The first time I really ever felt tight in the stomach with panic was when I interviewed you about your initial modelling, if we hadn't got on top of this, right back at the beginning of all of this. Tell me about the last 12 months. What's it been like, and how have we done collectively dealing with COVID-19?
Yeah, it's been very strange for a very strange year, hasn't it, for New Zealanders. And look, we've done extremely well. You know, we're consistently, you know, ranked first or second in the world in terms of our response. And look, you know, we've got to be honest, we didn't have the systems in place before we went into this crisis. It's actually relied on us pulling together and doing what was needed over the year. That's what got us through, not the preparation and the system. You know, a place like Taiwan was very well prepared because they'd had the experience of that original SARS outbreak. We had to really build this plane as we flew it, and we've been able to do it. And it's been, you know, it has been incredible to be part of it. But of course, there are lots of moments where it has been quite terrifying as well.
Well, thank you for everything you've done, helping us to build the plane as we flew it. Shaun Hendy, Professor Shaun Hendy from the University of Auckland, we so appreciate all your work and your kindness and always joining us on Breakfast. Thanks, Shaun. We're very grateful indeed.
Thanks.